Start the session. If you are not able to hear me, let me know. Okay. Morning class. Today's topic is recombinant DNA technology. We all know what is biotechnology and the term genetic engineering. Engineering is all the thing which we build or do, that is engineering. But genetic engineering is building the genetic things or related to our genes, that is genetic engineering. By definition, it is a method by which a living organism or its parts are used to incorporate a particular character to another living organism. By this, take a part or a living organism, and if you want to put another character in that part or that living organism to form another living organism, that is genetic engineering. How we can do this? There are a lot of methods, a lot of techniques. Today, what we'll learn is about recombinant DNA technology. Are you hearing me? Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
So, recombinant DNA. This DNA, it is formed by the hybrid combination of two DNA fragments derived from different sources. We take DNA of two different things and then we combine it. That is hybrid combination. In vivo, genes often undergo recombination, that is the natural process, that is embryo formation is one of the example of in vivo recombination. In eukaryotic organism, genetic recombination occurs by sexual union of egg and sperm cell, that is the embryo formation, that is in vivo recombination. In vitro, what happens? We can put the genes or sets of genes that are supposed to be recombined in vitro to produce new combinations that do not occur biologically. So we can mix two different types of DNA to form an hybrid DNA. That we can perform in vitro recombinations. How we can perform? Let me see. Recombinant DNA technology, it comes as a short note. So before starting the process, we'll see first the definition. Recombinant DNA technology involves isolation and manipulation of DNA to make chimeric or hybrid DNA molecule. What do you mean by chimeric? That we'll see in next slide. The other name for chimeric is hybrid. That is mixture of two things in simple words. This is the definition, that recombinant DNA technology involves the isolation and manipulation of DNA to make chimeric or hybrid DNA molecule. How this occurs, we will see in the further coming slides. Now, this character you must have seen in net a lot of time or in some movies. This character is from the Greek mythology and its name is Chimera. This word is taken from Greek mythology since it involves the combination of head of a lion, body of a goat and tail of a dragon. So these three, they combine and form one character that is known as chimera. From this Greek mythology, this name chimera has been taken to define this DNA, hybrid DNA. It is known as chimeric DNA. It is a fusion of various characters. So chimeric DNA is a recombinant DNA containing genes from two different species. Example, molecules containing both human and bacterial DNA sequences. How we utilize this? This we'll see in the process of formation of recombinant DNA. So you can say that recombinant DNA, in short, is a hybrid DNA or chimeric DNA, which contains two different species. In scientific language, here we are talking about human as well as bacteria. Hence, we call it as two different species. Now, there are four steps in the formation of recombinant DNA. First step is fragmentation of DNA by restriction endonuclease enzyme. What is this enzyme? We'll see in detail. Second step is isolation of specific human DNA. How to isolate that DNA which we want to be get hybridized or for recombination? Third step is insertion of isolated human DNA into vector to form chimeric or hybrid DNA molecule. Here, from the second step, we get this isolated human DNA and we put that or insert it into a vector. What is a vector? We will see when we come to this third step. To form a chimeric or hybrid DNA. This is your recombinant DNA. The fourth and last step is joining of two different cut DNA fragments by DNA ligase. How this different DNA they are joined together, this will see in the fourth step. So there are four steps for construction or forming of recombinant DNA. First is fragmentation by a certain enzyme, that is restriction endonuclease. Second is isolation. Third is insertion of that isolated fragment into the vector. And fourth is joining of these two cut fragments to form the recombinant DNA. Now, starting with the first step, first is the fragmentation of DNA by restriction endonuclease enzyme. This is your bacteria which produce the restriction endonuclease enzyme to protect against the invading viral or DNA RNA. One function of this enzyme restriction endonuclease enzyme to cut the DNA at a particular site. Second function is to protect against the invading viral DNA and RNA. Some bacteria produce this restriction endonuclease enzyme so that they can protect them against invading viruses from the DNA and RNA. Some slides here we are missing. Other name for this DNA enzyme restriction endonuclease is, they are known as cutters or scissors. Okay. So in order to transfer a gene, it is first selectively split from the parent DNA. This is usually achieved by restriction endonucleases, which are referred to as molecular scissors. The other name for this restriction endonuclease enzyme, it is molecular scissor. So that they cut the DNA at a specific site, which is required for further insertion and formation of recombinant DNA. Certain enzyme of bacteria restrict the entry of phages into host bacteria. Now this, the other function which we talked about before, that some bacteria when they produce this restriction endonuclease enzyme, they also serve as protection against various viruses to enter inside the bacteria. So this is that function which restrict the entry of phages into host bacteria. Here phages are this restriction endonuclease enzyme. This slide we were missing. This is the picture you can see here. This is an bacteriophage. I'll put this here. The bacteriophage, these enzymes were originally called restriction enzymes because why were they named given as restriction? Because their presence in the given bacterium restricted the growth of foreign infective bacterial viruses. Hence, they were given the name bacteriophages. This is one of the reasons why the restriction endonucleases were labeled as this. Secondary function is they cut the DNA of any source in a sequence specific manner in contrast to action of most other endonuclease which break DNA randomly. If you need a particular fragment of DNA for getting it to be recombinated, so you need to cut that fragment very carefully and you need only that much fragment only. So you need such enzyme, they can act and cut the fragment which is required by you, not to cut the whole DNA. Hence this restriction endonuclease enzyme, it cuts the DNA in sequence specific manner. Whatever sequence is required for recombination, only that sequence is being cut by this restriction endonuclease enzyme. And third point is this restriction enzymes are named according to the bacteria from which they are isolated. We'll see in other slides, like EcoRI, this is from Escherichia coli. Then BAMHI, it is from Bacillus aminolecithinium. Like this, we get the restriction endonuclease enzyme from various bacteria. Continue from here. What these enzymes do, they recognize the specific base sequences of double helical DNA. Usually 4 to 6 base pairs in length they can cut, not more than that. So whatever fragment which is required, 4 to 6 base pair fragment we cut and then leave the both strands within this sequence. Now most of the DNA sequences, they are recognized by the restriction endonucleases as palindromic. You all know what is palindromic? You have heard this term before, I guess. You know the meaning of palindromic?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
So here we'll talk with the help of DNA strands, that is both strands of DNA have same sequence when we read it in 5' to 3' direction, like here. So this is 5'-3' direction. The sequence is CTTAAG, and here also from 5' to 3' end, the sequence is CTTAAG. So this is an palindromic sequence. When you read the sequence, it is same for 5' to 3' end in both the strands. So this restriction endonuclease enzyme that read the palindromic sequence and then it cut that portion or fragment of DNA. There are two types of enzymes, restriction endonuclease enzyme, which cut the DNA in different patterns. First is some restricted endonucleases leave both strands of DNA so as to leave no unpaired bases on either side. These ends are often called blunt end. I'll show you the diagram. Here you can see This is the restriction endonuclease enzyme which cuts the DNA on both the sides so that there is blunt end. That means there is no overlapping or no sequences left unpaired. So this is known as blunt ends. Another type is sticky ends. Some restricted endonucleases make staggered cuts on the two strands, leaving 2 to 4 nucleotides of one strand unpaired at each, resulting end known as cohesive end or sticky end. You can see in this picture, this is the restriction endonuclease enzyme which is cutting the one strand of DNA from this end and then the other strand from this end. Strand from here and then this other strand from this side. So it will give us the sticky ends or cohesive end so that this portion of the strand is remained unpaired. Here also, see, this portion of the strand is unpaired. So this is the sticky end or cohesive end which is required for formation of recombinant DNA. This is the slide. Different restriction fragments of DNA can base pair with each other if they have sticky ends. This is the second type of restriction endonuclease enzyme, which is cutting the DNA in sticky ends so that there are unpaired bases there, which are complementary with the other fragment of DNA which we are supposed to hybridize. Therefore, two unrelated DNA fragments can base pair with each other if they were cleaved by the same restriction endonuclease enzyme. This is important. If you need to hybridize two different fragments of two different DNA, you need to use same restriction endonuclease enzyme to cut the fragment of DNA of both the human and bacteria so that when you combine that, these sticky ends get together since same restriction endonuclease enzyme has cut the fragment of DNA. So the unpaired bases will match with both the fragments. Is it clear? Here is an example of restriction endonuclease enzymes. Now, this is the restriction endonuclease name given, EcoRI, HIN3, TAC1, HPA1. These are some of the name of the restriction endonuclease enzyme. The source is from the bacteria. EcoRI is from Escherichia coli. Then HIN3 is from Haemophilus influenzae. TAC1 is from Thermus aquaticus and I1 from Haemophilus parainfluenzae. What is the role of these enzymes? They have specific sequence identity which is cut by this enzyme. Here you can see GAATTC and the palindromic sequences, again GAATTC if we read from 5' to 3' end. This enzyme, it cuts this DNA fragment at this G point and then up till this G on the another strand so that whatever sticky ends we are getting, they are unpaired but they match with, if we again cut with EcoRI, the other DNA fragment, they will match with this unpaired sequence. This way, the specific sequence identity for other enzymes here is given and the cutting points of the enzyme are also given. If you remember the name of 2 or 3, then also it is okay. The first step we have completed, that is the fragments of DNA with the help of restriction endonuclease enzyme. You know what is a restriction endonuclease enzyme? Then there are two ways it can cut. One is it gives blunt end, another is sticky ends. What we require for recombinant DNA formation? We require sticky end so that it can pair with the another fragment of DNA. Second step is isolation of specific human DNA. How do we isolate it? Whatever fragments the restriction endonuclease enzyme it cut, that we have to isolate so that we can use it for hybridization or recombination. Once DNA has been cleaved into fragments by restriction endonuclease enzyme, a particular fragment of interest can be separated by others by electrophoresis or HPLC. Now I won't go in detail of these two processes. This we have already learned earlier. Electrophoresis. This is a picture of electrophoresis. And this is the ladder. This side. Ladder, in short, is a comparison from which we can identify this part of DNA fragment. So here we have separated three DNA fragments. They are compared with the ladder. These two are same. And this is different one. This and this one. So ladder, in short, is a marker by which we can identify which fragment we are supposed to isolate so that we can use it for recombination purpose. Now this is one technique by which we can separate, that is electrophoresis. And another technique is HPLC. Third is insertion of isolated human DNA into vector to form chimeric or hybrid DNA molecule. A specific selected fragment of DNA of human genome is inserted into the vector. Vector is, if we want to mix something and then we keep it for incubation, we require something. Suppose we require a petri dish, so that will it will be vector, that is the carrier. You need something to insert that DNA fragment which you have isolated. You need something so that you can insert that into that fragment you will insert, and then it will be carried on for recombination. So that thing is known as vector. There is a carrier DNA molecule to which the fragment of DNA of interest is attached. Foreign DNA fragments cannot self-replicate in a cell. It will die. The cell won't allow it to enter inside. Hence, it will die. So, we require a carrier or vector so that it can carry that DNA fragment to replicate it along with it. Therefore, they are joined together to a vector that can replicate with the host cell. Here there are three types of vector which we can use. One is the plasmid. Another is bacteriophage. This we talked about earlier also. Then we have cosmid. So we have three vectors: plasmid, cosmid, and bacteriophage. This is an MCQ. What we do with these vectors? We take a restriction endonuclease enzyme. Here we have taken the example EcoRN, MHN. Any one of this, you take restriction endonuclease enzyme. That same enzyme will cut the vector DNA and human DNA. So these are two different DNA which we will be using for recombination. This restriction endonuclease enzyme, it will cut the vector DNA. Suppose we call it as DNA A, specifically at this site, and the same enzyme will cut the human DNA. Suppose we call it as DNA B at this level. Now we get sticky end, since this enzyme is cutting the DNA into this pattern. So what we get? Sticky ends, 5 dash we have G, and from 3 dash to 5 dash we have C, T, T, A, A. If you read the sequence of the human DNA which is cut by this restriction endonuclease enzyme, has the palindromic sequence of this vector DNA. Pi dash we have G, and on the first strand from pi dash to 3 dash we have AA, TT, C. So both this if we combine, they are the palindromic sequence. They are good for our recombination. Our second step is finish, that is the isolation. Third step is finish, that is the fourth is joining of two different cut DNA fragments by DNA ligase. Now we got this two fragments which are cut by same restriction endonuclease enzyme from human DNA as well as the vector DNA. Now we'll base pair this, or we'll join this with the help of the enzyme DNA ligase. Put the DNA ligase, this both sequences they will join. Here you can see, due to the sticky ends, we are able to join this two different fragments of DNA which are obtained from two different sources. Now, as you get this DNA fragment, recombinant DNA, this is only one portion of the DNA. What you need to do now, cloning means you need to amplify it so that it can be used for various purposes. Amplifying the quantity of DNA in vivo and cloning allows the production of large number of identical DNA molecules. There are two steps in the cloning or amplification. First is introduction of recombinant DNA into appropriate host cell. Now we require a host cell so that we can put this recombinant DNA so that it can replicate or amplify. Second step is amplification of recombinant DNA. This is the procedure of amplification or cloning of recombinant DNA. Select a vector. We have selected here plasmid as the vector. You select the fragment or site of cleavage which you are supposed to get for recombination. You select a human DNA which is supposed to be cloned or amplified. And in that human DNA, you select the site of cleavage or fragment which is supposed to be amplified. Now, you take the same restriction endonuclease enzyme, cut both the human DNA as well as vector DNA at the site of cleavage, and then you get the fragments. Now you join those fragments with the help of DNA ligase. You get a hybrid DNA or hybrid or recombinant DNA or chimeric plasmid, they have given the name, which contains recombinant DNA from plasmid as well as from the human DNA. Now we got a chimeric plasmid or a recombinant DNA which we are supposed to clone or amplify. We will choose a host cell. This is the host bacterial cell to amplify this DNA. First step was to transform the recombinant DNA into the host cell. So we are transforming this chimeric plasmid or recombinant DNA into this host bacterial cell. Now this bacterial cell is called as transformed bacterial cell. Got this transformed bacterial cell. The second step was to amplify this recombinant DNA for getting more and more copies. Now this is kept in the growth medium so that bacteria are grown to amplify recombinant DNA. From this we'll obtain the plasmid, which are recombinant plasmid. Then we can also obtain proteins from this, since while amplification, more and more proteins are generated. Grow under conditions permitted expression of clone gene. So this proteins we'll get, that we'll isolate and we can utilize it for further process. Now we isolate the amplified plasmids or chimeric plasmids which we got. Then we will cleave this with a specific restriction endonuclease enzyme, and that part of of recombinant DNA which we were supposed to obtain, that has amplified a lot. So that will cut with the help of restriction endonuclease enzyme. This you can see clone human DNA, which is required for various applications that we'll see now. These are the applications of recombinant DNA technology. First is molecular basis of disease. Molecular basis means what is the biochemical basis or biochemical things which are going wrong so that these disorders are occurring. I won't go in detail of this. You can just enumerate the disorders. With the help of recombinant DNA technology, you can find out the molecular basis. Familial hypercholesterolemia, sickle cell disease, thalassemia, this too you know confirm what is the molecular basis. Then is cystic fibrosis, last one is muscular dystrophy. Second application is diagnosis of various disorder. Various kits are available, use of which we can do the diagnosis of various disorder. Third is production of proteins. There are a lot of number of proteins. I have enumerated a few. This is asked in Viva. First is anticoagulant, tissue plasminogen activator. It is used in heart attack victim. Then human growth hormone. It is used to treat children with growth hormone deficiencies, or we can say example here is dwarfism. Next is erythropoietin. It is used for treatment of anemia. Now next is blood factor, like factor A. It is used to treat hemophilic patients. Next is insulin, a hormone used to treat diabetes. You are all familiar with this. This insulin, it is produced in recombinant DNA technology or with the help of recombinant DNA technology. Just as we have seen the process of formation of recombinant DNA, same it is, but human gene, which is responsible for insulin production, that is used as human DNA and it is inserted into a plasmid. And then it is joined, then amplified, and then the copies of that are obtained, or cloned or amplified parts of that are obtained, and that are used as insulin for treating the diabetes patient. Next is interferons. These are used for treatment of cancer. They are also formed from recombinant DNA technology. We have interleukins. These are useful in wound healing, then HIV infections, then various types of cancers and immune deficiencies. We have monoclonal antibodies, which are used in diagnostic tests. We have superoxide dismutase. This we have already learnt in our antioxidant class. This is also used in various surgery. Then we have vaccines, which are developed with the help of recombinant DNA technology. This is again an MCQ. The first successful DNA recombinant vaccine was produced for hepatitis B virus. Okay, this is an MCQ. Recombinant enzymes, which are formed with the help of this technology, are acid alpha glucosidase and alpha L iduronidase. I have quoted only two examples. There are many more. If ever asked in Viva or in MCQ, this too you can quote. Then recombinant HIV protein for HIV ELISA testing. This is helping us to find out more and more cases and treat them accordingly. Now we have tissue plasminogen activator. It is used to treat the strokes patient. These are some of the proteins which are produced with the help of recombinant DNA technology, and they are helpful in treating various disorders and diagnosis also. This was the third application. Fourth is prenatal diagnosis. With the help of amniotic fluid that is taken out, the process is known as amniocentesis, that is taking out the amniotic fluid, not much, 2 to 5 mL amniotic fluid for investigation purposes, so that when the fetus or embryo is there in the womb, some tests can be performed for diagnosing the genetic disorders, due to which if the fetus is not able to live after the delivery or after the child is born, then if these disorders are diagnosed at certain period during the pregnancy, then pregnancy can be terminated, so that the fetus is not having or the child is not having any genetic conditions. For example, we have trisomy, then Klinefelter syndrome. These are some of the genetic disorders. By amniocentesis, we can find out them. Fifth is genetic counseling. We all have seen this type of chart in sickle cell anemia and thalassemia. Some parents, they are carrier only. They are not totally having the disorder. Carrier means they can pass on their disorder to their progeny, but they do not have the disorder. So if the parents are carrier, how much chances is there for the progeny to get that disorder? That can be done with the help of genetic counseling or by testing these individuals or couple with the help of recombinant DNA technology. One such example is sickle cell anemia. This is always asked in sickle cell anemia. Pre-marriage counseling, pre-marriage genetic counseling for those couples which are carrier, they is done so that they don't get a sickle cell anemic child. There is, if both the parents they are carrier, then there is a chance of 25% that they will have a kid with that disorder, and 25% chance is there that the kid will be normal, and 50% chance is there that the kid will be a carrier. This type of counseling is done so that the couple, they don't get disorder passed on to their next generation. Now, screening tests in some type of cancer, if we perform this recombinant DNA technologies, we can early detect the cancer and then treatment can be done. Like Pap screening is done for endometrial cancer, cervical cancer, so that if the screening is done, the patient is in the preventive stage, we can give medicines and prevent the further development of that cancer. Next application is gene therapy. This we'll see in detail in our next class. Just for the application part, gene therapy for sickle cell disease can be utilized, but still it is in progress. For other disorders also, thalassemia, adenosine deaminase deficiency and other diseases may be devised. What is gene therapy? That we'll see in detail later. Currently, this is still in an experimental level, but this is one of the application of recombinant DNA technology. Next is production of genomic library. What we do is this, whatever data is collected about a certain human genome or human DNA, and whatever fragments are done with the help of restriction endonuclease enzyme, they are studied and then they are stored in a library. The data is saved in the library or genomic library, so that whatever information of certain disorder is there, that is read by or utilized by all the individuals for research or for diagnosis and treating the disorder. For example, phenylketonuria. This is the disorder occurring due to deficiency of enzyme in this phenylalanine. But this is a genetic disorder. So which part of the genome is affected, which gene sequence or DNA is affected, that is learned and then the data is stored in genomic library so that it can be utilized by others for diagnosing as well as treating purpose. Next is transgenic animals. Genes can be introduced into fertilized eggs from which transgenic animals develop, and these transgenic animals can produce normal offspring. Transgenic means containing genetic material into which DNA from a different organism has been artificially added. This is about transgenic animals. I'll give you an example. If you take a normal mice and you take an Babsi mice, they are utilized for research purposes. Nowadays, they have been banned. But few years ago, they were utilized for research purposes. So whatever was the level, or you can say their heart, liver, kidney, whatever histology we can see from them, that can be utilized for human research purpose. It is somewhat similar to human. So we use this transgenic animals for research purposes so that we can study them and then we can develop vaccines and treatment for human for various disorders. An example of this is Babsi mice. Next is in forensic medicine, this you're all aware of this. Special techniques like DNA fingerprinting. This is used by forensic medicine and by the crime department also for identifying various criminals. So this is one of the, you can say, recombinant DNA technology, which is helping the police department or crime department to solve a lot of cases. And commercially also, this is very useful, like in agricultural and industrial. Plants that are resistant to diseases, insects, herbicides, drought and temperature extremes, or more efficient at fixing nitrogen are being produced using recombinant DNA technology. And lastly, industrial application for production of various detergents, sugar and cheese, we use recombinant DNA technology. We produce various enzymes which are utilized for production of these kind of products in the industries. There are many more, but since we are talking about human, so I have kept this commercial application, only two are here. The rest are all related to human. This recombinant DNA technology, it comes as a short note. You are supposed to write down the definition, four steps, how they are formed, then elaborate a bit all the four steps with diagram. And then at lastly, applications. All 11 applications you write. Then if only application of recombinant DNA technology is asked, then also you give the definition and four steps by which how it is formed. Only write the four steps. Don't elaborate them in detail. And then write the applications. Move on to the last part of this lecture. This Human Genome Project. This is always asked in Viva. Since your syllabus has been a bit lengthy this time, so this is also, this can come as a short note. This is an international effort started in 1990. The goal was to sequence the entire genome. It is very difficult to sequence the entire genome. We call it as genome mapping. That is, what is there in your DNA? We have 23 chromosomes, and in that chromosome, there is a yard length DNA. So, sequence the entire genome was the goal of Human Genome Project. Not only of one individual, all the individuals of the world. So, one set of human DNA contains 3 billion base pairs and about 10,000 genes. This is again an MCQ. US Department of Energy and US National Institute of Health started this project in 1990. Again an MCQ. And James Watson headed the first project. Later, Francis Collins succeeded him. This too is again an MCQ as well as Viva. The project that included 16 countries worldwide. In 1997, Craig Venter of Celera Genomics had independently embarked on the project, and it has hastened the completion of the project by 2002. So it was started in 1990 and then it was completed in 2002. The gene map of human DNA was first published in 95. Then human chromosome 5 was sequenced in 98. So it takes a lot of time to complete the sequencing. You can see that in project was started in 90. But in 1998, human chromosome 5 was sequenced. Then in 99, human chromosome 16 was sequenced, and like this, it went on. Then in 2000, preliminary work draft was announced, and 2002, they declared that Human Genome Project was completed. But the, it is not the end of the project. It still goes on, since a lot of new individuals are born and the data keeps on growing. Book of Human Life contains 23 chapters. Why? Because it represents the 23 chromosomes. It is now possible to isolate any human gene of interest because of this Human Genome Project. Many previously unknown genes have been identified. Then pharmacogenomics is emerged from the genome project. It is the use of genetic information towards development of new drugs and the targets of action. Pharmacogenomics is from the genomic study, some drugs, they are utilized so that we can target the genes and treat that patient. That is known as pharmacogenomics. In 2003, the National Human Genome Research Institute initiated ENCODE, that is Encyclopedia of DNA Elements project, to identify all functional elements of genome. This project, it does not end. It keeps on going on. New things goes on coming, so that you can know your gene, your DNA in detail. Lastly, this is the last slide. CRISPR-Cas9. This is the new thing which is added in Fasten, Viva, and MCQ. The word CRISPR, it is for clusters of regularly interspaced short palindromic repeats. This is the full form of CRISPR. You should know it, learn it by heart, okay? And Cas, it stands for CRISPR associated system. So these two systems, they are combined. And what is this? CRISPR is another mechanism employed by the microbes which provide acquired immunity against viruses and plasmids. So this is the mechanism which is employed by the microbes so that acquired immunity can be provided against various viruses and plasmids. This is a new thing in human genomics. This protein Cas9, it is an enzyme, and it is similar to that of restriction endonuclease enzyme. It is helping in cutting the DNA strands like the molecular scissor. And show in the diagram, what is this? Short DNA sequences, we call it as SPAM, that is protospacer adjacent motifs. They serve as a tag on the target DNA which is supposed to be sequenced. Now this spacer, that is Cas9, they are taken from the viruses that previously attacked the organism. Why? Because they serve as a memories which enable the bacteria to recognize the virus and fight off the future attack. With CRISPR, with the help of this technology, it is possible to modify, delete, insert, and activate or inactivate any gene. But still, this is in process. This can be combined with gene therapy so that the modified gene can be delivered anywhere in the body, and whichever gene is affected, that can be rectified. Here, with the help of diagram, you can see the duplex of crRNA and tracer RNA. This is the tracer RNA and this is crRNA. Act as a guide RNA to introduce specifically located gene modification. Cas9, it binds the tracer RNA and needs a DNA binding sequence, that is SPAM. This is the DNA binding sequence. After binding of this Cas9 to this SPAM, it produces a DNA double strand break, which is then followed by gene modification by homologous recombination or non-homologous ending. So you can see that this Cas9, with the help of recessive DNA, it joins with the PAM, and then there is a break in the DNA, and then it modifies itself. Hence, this double strand break by Cas9 is helping correction of the gene and inserting into that place that needs the correction. Is it okay? So two new things we have learned along with recombinant DNA technology. One is Human Genome Project. Another is CRISPR. You remember that is asked in Viva and MCQ, and recombinant DNA comes as a short note. Okay, we have completed the lecture here. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Please send the PPT on WhatsApp.
Thank you.